Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, colleagues and friends, wherever you are in the world. My name is Victoria Granström. I am working as the environmental leader at IKEA Industry, and I am a member of the CEV Scientific Program Committee. This year, CEV's SPC members arrange 9 seminars with at least 3 sessions each. So this is seminar 7, the private sector, water and climate resilience in uncertain times. We do have some key collaborating partners. We have CEO Water Mandate as our key collaborating partner. And then we have co-conveners, which is, let's see if I can move around. We have IKEA and we have BCST as co-conveners. So we have been looking forward to meet you for a year now, since we were planning to have the seminar 7 in Stockholm last year. But as you know, most of us had to change our plans. So this year we meet online. So let's see. Seminar 7, session 1 took place on Monday, where you can find, if you go back, you can find several presentations about corporate leadership in the private sector. And seminar session 2 took place yesterday. And if you go back, you could listen to corporate representatives presenting the importance of collective actions and the strength of working together for climate and water resilience. But now I want to welcome you to session 3, where we have speakers presenting approaches and tools to integrate water risks in decision-making and work proactively towards water resilient basins and businesses. So I want to present the agenda today. We have presentations, we have 4 presenters, and after that, we have breakout rooms. So this is a super interactive session. So we hope that you will engage and join our breakout rooms. You will be automatically assigned after the presentations. So you will join rooms. There will be 3 rooms. I will present them after the presentations. And after the breakout rooms, we have reporting back and wrap up and closing of this session 3 and also seminar 7. So you are welcome to ask questions in Pathable chat. The chat function in Zoom will not be available, and in the breakout rooms, you will be able to unmute and ask questions directly to the participants. So if we then, there are also 2 polls, because we want to know a little bit more about you as participants. We want to know where you are from and what organization or company you are working for. So please go into Pathable. You can have split screens also so that you can follow the chat and write at the same time as you listen to us. So if we then go to our presenters. First, we have the regional responsible for SIA Samuel for Water Witness International. We'll start with the presentation, How Fair is Fashion's Water Footprint? You have 5 to 7 minutes, and I will remind you when you have 2 minutes left, SIA. So please, you are now able to share your screen.
Sorry, I was on mute. Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Yes.
Good. Thank you. Hello, everyone, and welcome to this session. So I will be talking about how fair is fashion's water footprint. My presentation will focus on studies that calls for action to tackle the global fashion industry's destructive impacts on Africa's water and workforce. So the study is based on data collection analysis and also over 20 key informant interviews in the case study countries. Yeah, so Africa is the rising star of the global textile and clothes production. That is because of reforms in trade agreements and also tax incentives and cheap labor force. And before the pandemic, Africa's fashion export generated about $4.6 billion a year. And also Africa has an important toehold in the global fashion industry. For example, in 2019, it was worth $2.5 trillion and employed over 75 million people. So regardless of the COVID pandemic, the fashion industry can play an important role in Africa's social and economic progress. Looking at who is who within the African fashion value chain, obviously the sector's giants are in the north, for example, Morocco, Tunisia, and Egypt. Those countries account for about 50% of the textile and garment export. And other than those countries, we find South Africa, Eswatini, Mauritius, Madagascar, Burkina Faso, Lesotho, Kenya, and also Tanzania. And several countries are already heavily dependent on the sector, which can generate up to 60% of their national revenue and as much as 30% of their GDP. And the key markets are in France, UK, Germany, Italy, and also if you take US, it imports about 685 million a year from Africa. And on the left side, you will see some of the brands who are sourcing from the case study countries. So our case study focused on five countries: Ethiopia, Tanzania, Mauritius, Madagascar, and Lesotho. And through the study, we have listed the top five impacts and water risks, which I will come to shortly. But addressing these problems identified in the reports and safeguarding Africa's water and workers must be a priority. So the first one is pollution of untreated effluent. So obviously there is some gap in terms of finding reliable data, but through our study and also field observation, we found reliable evidence that industrial effluents are causing pollution and then and affecting downstream users. And these pictures are from Tanzania, effluent released from industrial complex and textile company in Dar es Salaam, which is affecting the downstream who are depending on the river for their domestic and also irrigation purpose. The second one is inadequate water supply and sanitation and in hygiene. So there is multiple sources raise serious concern about the adequacy of access to clean water for the factory workers, as well as within the communities they are living in. Overall, the sanitation and hygiene and also water access in sub-Saharan African countries is very, very limited and low. The third one is sustainable, equitable, and resilient water use for production. This is obviously related with competing demand over a limited resource. So the industry is competing with a very limited water resource with a community or for their domestic use. And the fourth one is related with water risk in the supply chain. Obviously, the supply chain is not straightforward, as you can see from the illustration here. It's a very complex system, and also the water challenge is complex as well. Specifically, cotton production demands the use of a significant amount of water, as well as pesticide. And from the laser side, you can see laser processing is also chemical intensive during the washing part. But it doesn't end there, you know, it also goes to the consumer end as well. So this complex water risk in the value chain needs to be addressed. The fifth one is water governance challenge. So the root cause of this impact and risk is inadequate water management and governance. That means in one side, there is limited institutional capacity. And then on the other side, there is gap within the regulations and also policy and enforcement. There is also credible evidence in some countries that there is negligence or least prioritized towards corporate water governance. Overall, a less responsible water use becomes the operating norm. The reputational risk associated with poor water performance could destroy Africa's fashion sector in its infancy. So what is the response? So the response is water stewardship. So water stewardship is simply proactive and positive engagement of water users to manage water risks and opportunities. So this demands a fair water footprint through credible water stewardship. So there is an immediate action required to commit to fair water footprint in the fashion sector.
1 minute.
Sector, and every stakeholder has a role because water is everybody's business. So there is an effort required in this angle. So I started with five case study countries identifying the top five issues related to water risk. So I would like to conclude with five action points. So the first one is to step up and speak out for water. The second one is good water stewardship by companies. Demanding good water stewardship by companies. And the third one is to ensure your investments and banks don't abuse water. And fourth one is to put pressure on government for accountable and transparent water management. And last but not least, I would like to urge you to join our footprint, fair water footprint campaign. The link is here on the screen. Through this link, you can also find the details of our work in water stewardship in Africa. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Isaias. Very interesting. And you will stay and join a breakout room together with the corporate representative and also our one of the next speakers. So I'm sure we will have really interesting discussions in room number one. Yeah, thank you. I'm also very surprised, I would say, how fast growing the African textile industry really is. And of course, the urgency now to act according to the five steps. And so let's see, we're going to have our next speaker. And thank you, Samuel. We were going to have our next speaker. Let's see if I am Yeah, I can't see myself, but I hope that you can see. Okay, we are going to have our next speaker, Greg Brill, a senior researcher from Pacific Institute. But it seems like he has some internet difficulties. So Ashok, Chapagai, would it be possible for you to jump in a little bit earlier?
Yeah.
The Water Resilience Assessment Framework, right?
Fantastic. Thank you, Victoria. And Greg has some internet trouble connecting to the session now. He might be able to join in a bit. So I will try to take the slot which is available. Fortunately, I can join when everybody else is very up to date. And then careful. I might need a couple of minutes, 9 minutes, not 7 minutes. So excuse me if I go over the 7 minute time. So let me introduce you the project that we have been working for the last 1.5 years is the Water Resilience Assessment Framework. Welcome everyone to this presentation. This is a presentation of a milestone publication launched yesterday. I'm going to elaborate some of the key features of this framework in this short presentation. You can download the full document from the link displayed at the end. The project started in 2019. With financial support from BHP, SDC, and CEO Water Mandate Partner Organizations. The general water resilience.
Have you started to share your presentation?
I need to do something different. I need to just give me a second. It just went off. Technology.
Yes, surprises.
Yeah, it always surprises, yeah. So screen two. I think you should see it now. So I just started now.
Fabulous.
So I can just minimize this one. And we have a number of partners supporting this framework, mainly AGWA, WRI, EMI, CEO Water Mandate, and Pacific Institute. The project benefited from reviews and input from a range of experts, either as a member of a stakeholder advisory group or on individual basis. Mainly Fred Boltz and Frank Mary as well, who shaped the earlier discussions around the framework. We thank them all for joining hands in this exciting project. So let me quickly move to the slide which talks about resilience. Why resilience? Our world is changing. The changes could be gradual, predictable to some extent, but there could be shocks and stresses, bringing unpredictable and irreversible changes, such as climate change, population growth, and other impacts of anthropogenic activities and extreme events that can change the world that we know or in unknown ways. Some of these changes are gradual and can be predicted to some degree of confidence, but often these changes could be abrupt or unpredictable, such as who would have imagined that COVID would influence that we would be doing this webinar in this way. Or you could have system tipping over the point of no return. The changes are irreversible and the demand that demands new thinking. A linear approach such as with a fixed goal is insufficient to meet such evolving targets. Often enhancing efficiency, for example, by maximizing the output per unit of input, produces brittle solutions or leave no further room for maneuver. You wanna increase the supplies, there is no more room left anymore because you are already highly efficient in using the resources at hand. Hence, the solution must have inbuilt mechanism to tackle the impact of such shocks and stresses to become resilient in a changing system. The RAF is an attempt to provide such a holistic framework that informs resilient thinking, resilient decision-making to avoid the impacts of shocks and stresses becoming crises. Allowing globalization, the organizations survive and thrive despite shifting conditions. I'll quickly go over the framework itself. This is the core of the framework. It has 4 components in it, and stakeholder engagement is throughout these 4 components as and when needed. The framework presented is a high-level framework that can be adapted and applied to a specific stakeholder or from sectoral perspective. It is deliberately designed such that it is not overly prescriptive. It allows opportunities for context-specific inquiry. It is an invitation for stakeholders within a water system to explore the boundaries of these insights, strengthen system-wide understanding, and collaborate to build resilience. There are 4 steps in this framework. first to visualize the system, develop a strategy, and test the strategy and evaluate and go over these steps as you need. It means it is an iterative process. It can be revised and implemented in a cycle. That's step four. Applying RAF requires engagement from a range of stakeholders, depending on the relevant step or the challenges that we are facing. When conducting stakeholder engagement across groups, it is important to recognize that different stakeholders may interpret information results and actions differently and based on different priorities and their worldviews. So stakeholder engagement is also throughout the all the steps. I'll quickly go over these three steps mainly, so that if you want to read more about these steps, please go and download the document from the link provided at the end of the document. The first step is about visualizing the system. The process of tackling and building resilience begins with seeing the system. We need to know, we not only mean local reverberation here, the system also refers to interconnected socioeconomic, institutional, governance, infrastructure, management, and biophysical components that function as a whole. So a system is bigger than just the river basin that we normally see in traditional water accounting or other approaches. Even a relatively small scale, that boundary can often be connected to a larger scale. It all depends on the boundaries that's connecting to other components of the system. And the boundaries can also change over time. And we need to remember that not all system components will be relevant across all contexts. So once the boundaries are set, we are good to identify what are the water status and the trends, meaning that what is the past, present, and future of the different kind of services or the activity that we can have in the basin, for example, quantity and quality and availability, accessibility, all those kind of and numbers for present and past. So this is, and then the trend and status as well. And once we establish the current status under different shocks and stresses, and the drivers can bring different range of elements that's interacting, for example, with climate change and demographic change, economic trends and regulatory shifts, we might have a different future. And so we should be building resilience against these shocks and stresses. In step two, which is the most important step in the developing resilience strategy, understanding how the system is changing is important, and how it is anticipated to change, and that will inform the strategy selected. There are mainly three kinds of resilience strategies: persistence, adaptation, and transformation. In persistence, we try to go back to the normal solution, the existing situation as soon as possible. Whereas in adaptation, we already know there is a gradual change. So we try to adapt to the changes that can be predicted in the future. Whereas in transformation, there is a fundamental shift, system shift. So you really need to think differently. If what happens, for example, if there is a dam failure, if, for example, you no longer get all the services that you wanted to have, you cannot grow certain crop varieties in a climate change situation in a certain location. So those are the situations where you might need to think differently. So how do you measure the resilience? You need to understand there are six key characteristics of a resilience. When I say characteristics of resilience, it can be, for example, how robust are you? How flexible are you? Is your system? And how much redundancy you have left in the system? Or is your system equitable up here? So these six characteristics described in detail in the report itself are very key, central to identifying what resilience action you want to take.
One more minute, Ashok.
Thank you. So if you want to develop redundancy in your system, probably you want to think about actions that can further enhance the redundancy in the system. So that would inform the actions. I will quickly go to the next step where you would like to test the efficacy of the action that you have taken. You can read in detail how you can do the stress test in the report itself, but a stakeholder could develop a set of criteria and evaluate the intervention they have taken against the characteristics they have chosen and go back to the system analysis again to step two and then rinse and repeat. So this is an iterative process. It requires revisiting and refining previous steps based on the result of stress test. I wouldn't go through these slides. It's about how it complements to the existing approaches and practices. You can read about them in the document. Just a quick note about it. RAP is not intended to replace your existing water management tools and practices, but to supplement them. In the next step, the framework presented here is a multiple years of collaboration with a stakeholder, with a range of stakeholders and the organizations. In the final two phases of the project, in the next phase of the project, we would like to engage, develop guidance document and pilot with potential collaborators or partners. We are currently planning to develop three sector specific guidance documents for utilities, urban planners, second corporates, and then third basin authorities. These documents will be published in a sequence in 2022. We are also developing a library of cases. Finally, we are beginning to explore potential partnerships in parallel for piloting. We welcome you to join the process and then lead the way forward. And if you need further information about the project, I would encourage you to download the document from the link in this slide, or more about the project itself from the website itself. Or if you have any particular question and want to explore further opportunities to collaborate, please email me directly at that link. Thank you very much. And you would have opportunity to ask questions in the breakout room as well and in the chat function as well. Thank you. Cheers. Over to you, Victoria. Victoria, you muted.
Yes. Hi. Thank you so much, Ashok, for taking over quickly and presenting such a fresh report and insights. It was even warm, almost directly from the publication office. Yeah. So thank you, Ashok. Looking forward to the discussion in the breakout room number two. No. Yes. Let's see. You are in breakout room number two. So Greg, are you ready to start to share a presentation? I hope your connection. No, Greg, it seems like the connection is poor where Greg is. We were hoping to have you, hope that you will manage to join us in a few minutes then. But Francesca, would you be ready to present offering the transition towards water-aware businesses?
Yeah, sure. I'll try to share my screen first. If this works, I'm ready. Can you see my screen?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. Thanks, Victoria, for the opportunity and for the introduction. So I'm Francesca Recanati. The Senior Technical Manager at the Climate Disclosure Standards Board. And this presentation is about disclosures and about reporting standards and how they can drive the understanding of the importance of water for business and investors. Okay. So like, first of all, why water and water disclosure? So, and water and business. So what water is, water and what and related issues are such as scarcity, droughts and floods are material for companies. And when I say material, I mean also financially material. Think about the recent floods and drought events, and they have business implications. As a consequence, investors are increasingly becoming aware of this and asking companies to be transparent on their interaction with water. Besides investors, also regulators are demanding for more and better environmental and sustainability disclosures, and standard setters, both at the regional and international levels are evolving. Here I just included one example from the IFRS, that is the foundation that regulates the financial standards, reporting standards, and now it's moving also to sustainability. And at the regional level, we have, for example, Europe above all. these, all of these aspects mean that mandatory sustainability disclosure will increase. I'm not sure exactly when in the future, but it will happen. And water is a crucial resource for business and for our lives. And it is linked to other environmental and social issues. And for this reason, it should be considered in the majority, if not all, sustainability disclosure. So it's a crucial topic. On the corporate side, we are seeing some improvements in water-related disclosures in corporate mainstream reports. So when I say mainstream report, I mean like companies, ENMA reports or financial filings, 10Ks in the US. So we see improvements, but according to our research we conducted on the biggest EU companies on their 2020 report, the majority are disclosing like water metrics, but what it's